Please join with me, Bill.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm not gonna give you a speech because they're complaining about us.
Okay. If I had known I was gonna have to follow those two young people, I think I would have declined the honor. If you need evidence in a group like this, it probably does not, but the caliber of people that are protecting us, specifically in this case in terms of the Navy, you have two wonderful examples of it here today. Thank you. Take my cheat sheet here because between my eyesight, my hearing, and my age, I don't want to miss too many of the things that I'd like to share with you. The Air Museum, as I think most of you know, is alive and doing very well. How many of you have been to the Air Museum? Back up, how many of you are members of the museum? Wow. How many of you are active volunteers at the museum? The latest statistic, I pulled it up this morning before I left the house. The volunteers at the Air Museum, and we have about 320 active volunteers, a number of others that are on the roll, but for whatever reason, don't put in regular hours, are no longer able to, perhaps. But as I say, north of 300, in the 20 and a half years that the museum has been in existence, volunteers have put in 1 million, as of yesterday, 1,156,000 hours.
Wow.
So whatever you think a volunteer is worth, and on some days that's a lot, on other days not so much, multiply that out, and there's no way an institution such as the museum could exist without volunteer efforts. Another piece of the equation is the staff. For an operation that size, we only have 12 paid employees, a couple of part-time situations, but basically 12 full-time paid employees. And they work very, very hard. We are blessed with not only wonderful volunteers, but a wonderful staff. Similarly, the museum owes its existence and much of its continuing prosperity to Bob Pond. And folks in this room are old enough to remember him, whether or not in person, before he had passed away. It took someone with his foresight, his enthusiasm, his money, his dedication to the idea to make it work. There were other gentlemen in Palm Springs that wanted a museum and kept talking about it, but the hurdles to get from the talking to the doing were kind of huge. And Bob Pond never met a hurdle he didn't dislike and conquer. Really quite a guy. And his generosity and his dedication to the museum continues because when he passed away, his will provided that the museum have the opportunity to purchase the 14 aircraft that did not already belong to the museum. The 14 aircraft, and they're very much the kernel, the key to the collection. Some of them are almost priceless. He gave the museum the opportunity to purchase them over a period of time at significantly below market value even then, let alone what's happened since, with no escalation, no interest, and we're about a third of the way in paying against that obligation. And it's without that core, we wouldn't have made it. Similarly, we've been blessed with some very generous board members. It seems that when the museum needs something, there's always somebody that steps up and agrees to pick up the tab. And the addition now, as I'm sure you all know, the fourth hangar, a General Miles hangar, is going to make a big difference in several ways. It's going to be approximately the same size as each of the existing three hangars. It's going to be dedicated to the Korean and Vietnam conflicts. It's going to give us an opportunity to sort out the collection. Right now, it's gotten a little mixed. I'll give you just one specific example. Our B-25 that the general public tends to associate with the raid of Tokyo is in the European hangar. Well, the public, that particular plane seems to mean more if we tie it in with the story we try to tell in the Pacific hangar. And there are a half dozen of such examples. So we're going to try to make a little more logical layout of the aircraft with the hangars. Similarly, we simply needed more space to keep some of these priceless airplanes out of the desert sun. Not the newspaper, the weather. thank God for the newspaper. Just as we've been blessed with the volunteer activities, we've been blessed with the opportunity to acquire aircraft. And the pace has increased because being a non-profit, non-governmental air museum, and most, that's the description of almost all of them, and certainly the smaller ones, is a very tough business. And as a result, we find ourselves being offered more aircraft than we can accommodate. In some cases with a price tag, in other cases simply people that want to make sure that their aircraft is going someplace that is going to be properly cared for. That was another motive in getting the fourth hangar. We needed a fourth hangar because one of our sources of income is to make our facility available for evening events once we're closed. Our costs are negligible, other than a little security and some utilities. It's found money when we're able to rent out a hangar at night for a legitimate event. It's also been very disruptive to things, so we had to keep moving the airplanes in and out. Confusing to the daytime customers who came to see something, not to watch a tug pulling an airplane. And obviously, there's inevitably a certain amount of damage sooner or later that occurs when you move that stuff around. So this will lessen the need to move aircraft, because the hangar has been specifically designed in a way that it will be the principal hangar for such evening events. And it has whoop-de-do lighting and audio-visual equipment and all the things that will make it even more desirable. And there aren't many areas like that available to renters, if you will, in the city. Another thing that ties in, I don't know how many of you live within earshot of what goes on out at the polo fields, but that's turned out to be a very pleasant surprise to the museum of late. Golden Voice is a delightful outfit to work with. And of course, they're in a business that generates incredible amounts of money. So they are willing to share for services they need. There's a noise ordinance in the city of Palm Springs. The residents a few years back said they were tired of the evening events, too many parties, too much noise. So there's an ordinance, you can't have amplified music after 10 a.m. There's one exception, obviously, the airport, because airplanes make noise. We happen to be on the airport. So we are immune to the noise regulation. So we're able to rent out, not the hangars, because we wouldn't subject them to the crowd that would show up for most of those events. What we rent out is the space behind the hangars, the ramp area between the buildings and the active runway. We rent that out to Golden Voice. Very lucrative, and again, zero cost. So these are all the things that make this succeed as a business, even though we're a nonprofit business. We were blessed about 5.5 years ago when Fred Bell, who had been on our board for a while, agreed to step up and become managing director. It is nominally a part-time job, for which he receives a very modest stipend while he continues to try to start his own business on the side. He has been a godsend because his background is in all these public attraction exhibit type businesses. He started with the Edwards Theater, the movie theater chain, the Cinemax, the SeaWorld, and then with Disney, the last stint with Disney. And as a result, all the key managers in the museum have been put through Disney University. And it's brought them back with a level of sophistication as to how to focus on the customer. Because if they don't go away happy with us, they're not going to tell other people we're worth visiting, and they're not going to come back to us, they're not going to volunteer, they're not going to donate. It's a cascade. He's got that thing flowing in the positive direction. He knows when to spend money. You see our name in the newspaper all the time, usually spelled correctly. And it pays off. There's a direct correlation between the number of inches we purchase of the Desperate Sun at a very nice rate with the attendance. There's an immediate payback. This is why we've been around for 20 years and why we're in good shape financially. Now let me think of anything else that might be of interest to you folks, knowing you're more familiar with us than most people are, than the general public. You're aware that CNN selected us, unbeknownst to us until they made the announcement, as one of the 14 best air museums in the world and the best air museum in the state of California. And got some pretty tough competition. A couple of things on the calendar coming up. We know our business, of course, is seasonal. And we're coming up now to the end of what has been another good tourist year. And we're exceeding all of our bogeys in terms of headcount, revenues, gift shop, all the ways in which you measure a business are doing fine. Saturday the 27th, we're going to have the official, ribbon cutting on the General Miles Hangar, the fourth hangar. And that ought to be a very nice event. And I say Saturday the 27th. And then they come in rapid succession. On the 28th, we have an unusual exhibit. It will be a permanent exhibit, but it will be the unveiling again of a new exhibit. It's dealing with gliders. And those of you in the age of most of us in this room, remember in World War II, gliders were perceived as being almost a magic bullet. They didn't turn out to be that way. The losses were horrendous. There were variables in the way they could be used. But nevertheless, it was a significant snapshot, a narrow focus on a part of the war that involved aviation. And there's a family in the area by the name of Sirota. The grandfather was an instructor pilot, a glider instructor pilot, and he was scheduled to go overseas for D-Day. And there was a minor accident, and he didn't go. Of course, as it turned out, that was probably fortunate for the family because most of the glider pilots that participated in D-Day didn't go anywhere after that. The family made a very generous donation to the museum in his honor, and we in turn have offered to create an exhibit trying to make sure folks don't forget what gliders meant, and maybe more importantly, what we thought they were going to mean as opposed to what actually happened. Because keep in mind, as we try very hard to remind ourselves of this at the museum, keep in mind why we're there. It's not just to provide employment for the tiny staff we had, or to provide a place for a golden voice to make noise in Palm Springs. We are there to preserve parts of history that are rapidly becoming priceless. Whether it's the hardware, or whether it's related objects, or whether it's the recordings of the interviews we conduct with veterans. Education is a key responsibility at the Air Museum. The time we spend with the kids, the money we spend on the kids, if you think about the economic situation in many parts of the valley, where the kids can't afford to eat properly and where the schools have to feed them, what are the odds of those kids ever having the wherewithal to come to an air museum? This year we were able to accommodate over 5,000 kids. And not only is it a case of letting them in the place, but how do they get there? We furnish the buses. And when they get there, they have to eat. How do they eat? We feed them. So we're lucky in terms of money, but we're putting it to some pretty good uses. Any questions?